Hello, welcome to the Hurricane Utah Adult Religion Class, sponsored by the Hurricane Utah North Stake of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. I'm Mike Parker, the class instructor. The Hurricane Utah Adult Religion Class meets on Thursday evenings between September and May to discuss the scriptures of the restored Church of Jesus Christ. If you live in or are visiting the Hurricane St. George area, I'd love to have you join us. The time and location are available on the class website. Links to the class website are available in the show notes for this video. On the website, you can download my notes, which includes footnotes documenting my sources, this PowerPoint slide presentation, and handouts that I distribute in class. Please note that this YouTube channel and the class website are not official sites of The Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints, the Hurricane Utah North Stake, or any other church unit or department. I alone am responsible for these sites and the materials on them. If you enjoy this lesson, please click the like button and share it with a friend. And if you haven't already subscribed, please do so. That way you'll be notified when new content is posted to this channel. In this lesson, we'll be looking at the writings of Moroni, found in Mormon chapters 8 and 9, Ether chapters 4, 5, and 12, and Moroni, chapters 1 through 6. The key individual in this lesson is Moroni, the son of Mormon. He was the final scribe on the plates of Mormon after his father's death at the battle at Cumorah. The outline of events for this lesson is, in Mormon, chapters 8 and 9, Moroni finished the record of Mormon after his father's death. In Ether, chapters 4, 5, and 12, Moroni commented about the coming forth of the Book of Mormon in the last days and the nature of faith. In Moroni chapters 1 through 6, Moroni wrote a few more things. These writings mostly concerned how ordinances were performed in the Church of Christ among the Nephites. In the lesson before last, we concluded with the end of Nephite civilization at the Battle of Cumorah, which took place 385 years after the signs of the birth of Christ, circa AD 376. 15 years passed before Moroni added anything to his father's record. This was the 400th year, circa 390. After waiting at least another 21 years, Moroni revealed, "I have not as yet perished." And he wrote a few more things. This would have been at least the 421st year, circa AD 411. Thus, Moroni wandered alone for at least 36 years before bearing the record started by his father, Mormon. There are only a few specific geographical indicators in Moroni's own record. He informed us that the land southward was controlled by Lamanites, and the last remaining Nephites who tried to escape to the south were hunted by the Lamanites until they were all destroyed. At first, Moroni wrote, "I have not friends, nor whither to go." He later wrote that since the Lamanites put to death every Nephite that will not deny the Christ, he wandered whithersoever I can for the safety of mine own life. The only direction he could have taken was north, away from Lamanite-controlled lands, leaving behind most of the records his father had buried in the Hill Cumorah. He took with him the Plates of Mormon, which he intended to complete and then hide up in the earth. Recapping from previous lessons, Mormon, commander of the Nephite armies, led his people in their last stand against the Lamanites at the Hill Cumorah. The Nephites were defeated. All of them were killed, including Mormon. Only Moroni remained alive. We've come full circle from our first lesson in which we discussed the title page of the Book of Mormon. BYU professor Sidney B. Sperry conjectured that Moroni wrote Mormon chapter 8 verses 1 through 13 as his original farewell, and then wrote the first paragraph, as we now have it, of the title page of the Book of Mormon. Sometime later, perhaps after many years, Moroni recommenced writing with Mormon chapter 8 verse 14, identifying himself as the same person who hideth up this record unto the Lord, and expounding on a completely new topic, that of the coming forth of the Book of Mormon in the last days. After finishing his father's book, and also abridging the record of the Jaredites, Moroni then proceeded to add the second paragraph of the title page, in which he mentioned the Book of Ether and the threefold purpose of the Book of Mormon. Sometime after that, Moroni noted with grim humor, "I have not as yet perished," and he proceeded to write his own book of Moroni. 15 years after the death of his father, Mormon, Moroni had a few things to write to finish the record of his father. This was his first farewell. He first brought us up to date on what had happened to the handful of Nephites who had survived the battle at Cumorah. Those who tried to escape to the south were hunted down and killed by the Lamanites, and his father had also been killed in battle. Moroni lamented, quote, "And I, even I, remain alone to write the sad tale of the destruction of my people. I have not friends, nor whither to go, and how long the Lord will suffer that I may live, I know not." Unquote. Moroni was living on borrowed time. He had no idea how long he would survive, and he would later express genuine surprise when he continued to live long after the final battle. He didn't know if the Lamanites would slay him also, so he intended to write and hide up the records in the earth, and whither I go, it mattereth not. The bleak hopelessness of his statement is striking. The only remaining people in Moroni's vicinity were Lamanites and robbers, and the Lamanites were at war one with another, and the whole face of this land is one continual round of murder and bloodshed. The only people who knew the true God were the three Nephite disciples. The Lord had taken them out of the land 75 years ago, but Moroni and his father had seen them, and they have ministered unto us. He promised those who receiveth this record, the Book of Mormon, and shall not condemn it because of the imperfections which are in it, shall know of greater things than what is contained within its pages. He then made an end of speaking concerning this people, identifying himself as the Son of Mormon. Sometime later, according to Sidney Sperry's premise, Moroni picked up his stylus again and wrote about the coming forth of the Book of Mormon in the last days. "These plates thereof," he wrote, "are of no worth, because of the commandment of the Lord. For he truly saith that no one shall have them to get gain." The information on the plates, however, was of great worth. He twice invoked a blessing on "he that shall bring this record to light," referring to Joseph Smith, "for it shall shine forth out of darkness and come unto the knowledge of the people, and it shall be done by the power of God." The Lord's warning, "No one shall have the plates to get gain," was directed specifically to Joseph Smith, whose family was nearly always on the brink of abject poverty. When Joseph first saw the gold plates in 1823, his initial thought was about their incredible monetary value. The angel Moroni chastened him for not keeping the Lord's commandments, and he told Joseph to come back to the hill every year on the same day until he was ready to receive them. It took 4 years of repentance and preparation for Joseph to be entrusted with the plates of Mormon. Moroni then issued warnings to those who would condemn the Book of Mormon for its imperfections, those who would threaten violence unless they were shown the gold plates, and those who shall breathe out wrath and strifes against the work of the Lord and against the covenant people of the Lord. These people will suffer the Lord's condemnation, and the eternal purposes of the Lord shall roll on until all his promises shall be fulfilled. He promised that the Lord will remember the covenant which he hath made with the descendants of Lehi, and the Book of Mormon would come forth out of the earth by the hand of the Lord, and none can stay it. And it shall come in a day when it shall be said that miracles are done away, and when the power of God shall be denied, and destruction, war, and wickedness would cover the earth. Moroni also condemned churches in the last days that would be built upon pride, materialism, and secret combinations. He warned them in Mormon chapter 8, verses 35 to 37, quote, "Behold, I speak unto you as if ye were present, and yet ye are not. But behold, Jesus Christ hath shown you unto me, and I know your doing. And I know that ye do walk in the pride of your hearts, and there are none, save a few only, who do not lift themselves up in the pride of their hearts, unto the wearing of very fine apparel, unto envying, and strifes, and malice, and persecutions, and all manner of iniquities. And your churches, yea, even every one, have become polluted because of the pride of your hearts. For behold, ye do love money, and your substance, and your fine apparel, and the adorning of your churches, more than ye love the poor, and the needy, the sick, and the afflicted." Unquote. Moroni then left a message to those who do not believe in Christ. He asked rhetorically if, when the day of the Lord's coming arrived, and they stood before him, then will ye say that there is no God, or deny the Christ? Those who have a consciousness of guilt will be more miserable to dwell with a holy and just God than ye would to dwell with the damned souls in hell. He pleaded with the unbelieving, quote, "Turn ye unto the Lord, cry mightily unto the Father in the name of Jesus, that perhaps ye may be found spotless, pure, fair, and white, having been cleansed by the blood of the Lamb at that great and last day." Unquote. He next wrote to you who deny the revelations of God and say that they are done away and that there are no spiritual gifts. He testified that God is the same yesterday, today, and forever, and in him there is no variableness, neither shadow of changing. Therefore, he remains a God of miracles. God is an unchangeable being, otherwise he would cease to be God. Moroni explained that the reason why God ceaseth to do miracles among the children of men is because that they dwindle in unbelief and depart from the right way and know not the God in whom they should trust. He exhorted unbelievers to despise not and wonder not, doubt not, but be believing. Moroni then composed his second farewell. "Behold," he wrote, "I speak unto you as though I spake from the dead." He again pleaded with readers in the last days to not condemn the Book of Mormon because of the imperfections of its authors. It was written in characters which the Nephites called the Reformed Egyptian, which no other people knew, hence the need for seer stones to translate it. This modified Egyptian script was more compact than Hebrew, and therefore more prone to error. At the beginning of the Book of Mormon, Nephi the First had explained that he wrote in the language of my father, which consists of the learning of the Jews and the language of the Egyptians. In other words, he wrote Hebrew words using an Egyptian script. This same script was the one on the brass plates. Lehi was taught in the language of the Egyptians, therefore he could read these engravings on the brass plates and teach them to his children, that thereby they could teach them to their children. This writing style was passed down through the generations and was used by Moroni. He wrote that it was called among us, that is to say by the Nephites, the Reformed Egyptian. There was no recognized ancient language called Reformed Egyptian. It was unique to the brass plates and the Nephites. None other people knoweth our language, Moroni explained. Moroni closed his father's book with a prayer that the Lamanites would be restored to the knowledge of Christ through the covenant God had made with the house of Israel. After finishing his father's record, Moroni decided to write more. So he next abridged the history on the 24 gold plates of the Jaredites onto the plates of Mormon. 6 times Moroni interrupted the historical narrative to expound and comment on key doctrinal points. About 1/5 of the Book of Ether contains Moroni's commentary. In our last lesson, we reviewed the history of the Jaredites in the Book of Ether. In this lesson, we're going to look at 3 chapters of extended commentary by Moroni on the themes in that book. After Moroni abridged the account of the Lord's appearance to the brother of Jared on Mount Shelem, he paused to discuss the future of the record he was writing. He began by repeating what the Lord had told the brother of Jared. The record of Christ's appearance to the brother of Jared was to be kept secret until after Christ's resurrection. Moroni restated this because he intended to use it as a theme for his commentary in chapter 4. Since the time of Christ's appearance in Bountiful, the Nephites had all dwindled in unbelief, and the Lamanites had rejected the gospel of Christ, so the Lord commanded Moroni to seal up the things which the brother of Jared saw, along with the interpreters, or seer stones, the Lord had given to the brother of Jared. The things which the brother of Jared saw included not only the appearance of Christ on Mount Shelem, but also the brother of Jared's vision of all things from the beginning to the end of the world. The record of this vision was included by Moroni in the sealed portion of the Plates of Mormon, which is the subject he turned to next. Moroni had previously written that the Book of Mormon would come forth in a time when there would be great wickedness and disbelief. Speaking of the teachings in the sealed portion now, Moroni wrote, "They shall not go forth unto the Gentiles until the day that they shall repent of their iniquity and become clean before the Lord. That day will not come until people exercise faith in me, saith the Lord, even as the brother of Jared did, that they may become sanctified in me." Those who will fight against the Lord's word and deny his revelations will be accursed. Those who will believe the Lord's word will receive the manifestations of my spirit and shall know that these things are true, for it persuadeth men to do good, and whatsoever thing persuadeth men to do good is of God. Through Moroni, the Lord called to both the Gentiles and the house of Israel to rend that veil of unbelief and receive the great and marvelous things which have been hid up from the foundation of the world because of unbelief, wickedness, hardness of heart, and spiritual blindness. These things can only be received by calling on God with a broken heart and a contrite spirit. When that happens, the revelation of John will be unfolded in the eyes of all the people, and they will know that the time is at hand, that those prophecies will be fulfilled. The appearance of the Book of Mormon is also one of the signs of the times. The Lord then again extended his call to every individual to repent and be baptized, with the promise to the faithful that they shall be lifted up to dwell in the kingdom of God. Ether chapter 5 contains a message from Moroni to the translator of the Book of Mormon. He began with a commandment and a warning to not touch the material in the sealed portion of the Plates of Mormon in order that he might translate the remainder of the record. Joseph Smith described the plates as having, quote, "the appearance of gold. Each plate was 6 inches wide and 8 inches long, and not quite so thick as common tin. They were bound together in a volume, as the leaves of a book, with 3 rings running through the whole. The volume was something near 6 inches in thickness, a part of which was sealed." Unquote. Joseph did not indicate the quantity or percentage of the plates that was sealed, but others who saw the plates did. David Whitmer, one of the 3 witnesses of the Book of Mormon, stated that the sealed portion was a large portion of the leaves, consisting of between 1/2 and 2/3 of the plates. Moroni revealed to the future translator of the Book of Mormon that he may be privileged to show the plates by the power of God to three witnesses, and that their testimony and the work itself should stand as a testimony against the world at the last day. This is the earliest that Joseph Smith would have been made aware that there would be witnesses who would see the plates and testify to their reality and truth. I imagine it would have been a tremendous burden lifted off his shoulders to know that the world wouldn't have to accept the account of how the Book of Mormon was revealed and translated based on his word alone. Later, when Joseph translated the small plates of Nephi, he came across Nephi's prophecy that the eyes of none shall behold the plates, save it be that three witnesses shall behold it by the power of God, and they shall testify to the truth of the book and the things therein. Shortly after translating Nephi's writings, Joseph received a revelation indicating that Oliver Cowdery, David Whitmer, and Martin Harris would obtain a view of the plates. And after that you have obtained faith and have seen them with your eyes, you shall testify of them by the power of God. In late June or early July 1829, these three men were shown the plates of Mormon, the interpreters, and other items by the angel Moroni. Their testimony has been published in every authorized edition of the Book of Mormon since 1830. Other than the personal witness of the Holy Ghost, their collective and individual testimonies are the most powerful evidence that Joseph Smith obtained the plates and translated the Book of Mormon in the manner that he said he did. Later in the Book of Ether, Moroni introduced us to Ether, the last Jaredite prophet, and told us that Ether taught faith, repentance, hope, and good works. At this point, Moroni interrupted his narrative to comment on faith. He began by defining what faith is. Ether chapter 12, verse 6, quote, "And now I, Moroni, would speak somewhat concerning these things. I would show unto the world that faith is things which are hoped for and not seen. Wherefore, dispute not, because ye see not, for ye receive no witness until after the trial of your faith." Unquote. There are three aspects of faith that Moroni mentioned. The first is the nature of faith. Faith is things which are hoped for and not seen. I would expand seen to include heard and touched. Faith is believing in things for which one cannot provide tangible evidence. Faith reveals truths, but it does it in a way that is separate and distinct from the natural or scientific method. It requires a leap of faith, taking a step into the darkness before knowing with certainty there is solid ground on which your foot will land. "Dispute not because ye see not" is Moroni's encouragement for us to retain faith in the absence of immediate evidence. Healthy skepticism is a good thing. It keeps us from drinking things we suspect may be poisonous and venturing into the woods at night where there may be wolves and bears. But one can become too skeptical, always demanding proof before believing. Alma encouraged the impoverished Zoramites to awake and arouse your faculties, even to an experiment upon my words, and exercise a particle of faith, even if ye can no more than desire to believe. We're not expected to rely on faith alone forever, though. Moroni promised that evidence will present itself after our faith has been tested. We will receive that witness after the trial of our faith. A little further on, Moroni told us that neither at any time hath any person wrought miracles until after their faith. As Spencer W. Kimball famously phrased it, the witness and the miracle follow rather than precede the faith. Bonnie L. Oscarson, Young Women General President, taught, quote, "In our world, where instant gratification is the expectation, we are often guilty of expecting the reward without having to work for it. I believe Moroni is telling us that we must do the work first and exercise faith by living the gospel, and then we will receive the witness that it is true. True conversion occurs as you continue to act upon the doctrines you know are true and keep the commandments day after day, month after month." Unquote. Apostle Richard G. Scott explained, quote, "Every time you try your faith, that is, act in worthiness on an impression, you will receive the confirming evidence of the Spirit. As you walk to the boundary of your understanding into the twilight of uncertainty, exercising faith, you will be led to find solutions you would not obtain otherwise. With even your strongest faith, God will not always reward you immediately according to your desires. Rather, God will respond with what in His eternal plan is best for you, when it will yield the greatest advantage. Be thankful that sometimes God lets you struggle for a long time before that answer comes. That causes your faith to increase and your character to grow." Unquote. In Ether chapter 12, Moroni recorded 9 examples of how the power of faith was displayed in the lives of individuals. By faith, Christ showed himself unto the Nephites after his resurrection, and he showed not himself unto them until after they had faith in him. By faith, they of old, the patriarchs in the Old Testament, were called after the holy order of God. By faith, the law of Moses was given, and by faith, it was fulfilled in the Son of God. By faith, Alma and Amulek caused the prison to tumble to the earth in the city of Ammonihah. By faith, the brothers Nephi and Lehi wrought the change upon the Lamanites in the land of Nephi, that they were baptized with fire and with the Holy Ghost. By faith, Ammon and the other sons of Mosiah performed a great miracle among the Lamanites, which I take to mean the conversion of the anti-Nephi Lehis. By faith, the 3 Nephite disciples obtained a promise that they should not taste of death. By faith, many people, even before the time of Christ, could not be kept from within the veil and saw great visions. One example Moroni gave was the brother of Jared, who first saw the Lord's finger and then his entire personage. By faith, the Nephite prophets received the Lord's promise that the Book of Mormon would come forth in the last days to the Lamanites through the Gentiles. Moroni confessed that he had despaired to the Lord that the Gentiles in the last days would mock the Book of Mormon because of our weakness in writing. The spoken words among the Nephites were mighty, powerful, and great, but because of the awkwardness of our hands, we could write but little, and when we write, we behold our weakness and stumble because of the placing of our words. The Lord responded forcefully to him. Ether chapter 12, verses 26 through 28, quote, "And when I had said this, the Lord spake unto me, saying, Fools mock, but they shall mourn. And my grace is sufficient for the meek, that they shall take no advantage of your weakness. And if men come unto me, I will show unto them their weakness. I give unto men weakness, that they may be humble. And my grace is sufficient for all men that humble themselves before me. For if they humble themselves before me, and have faith in me, then will I make weak things become strong unto them. Behold, I will show unto the Gentiles their weakness, and I will show unto them that faith, hope, and charity bringeth unto me the fountain of all righteousness." Unquote. Those who gain a testimony of the Book of Mormon overlook its minor flaws and gain a witness of its deeper message, its complexity, and the power of its teachings. Likewise, if we are humble, The Lord will turn our weaknesses, our trials, and our afflictions into strengths. The attributes we possess that are our greatest failings can, in the hand of the Lord, become our greatest assets. The trials we pass through mold us, shape us, and prepare us to serve Him more effectively. Moroni took comfort in the Lord's response, for he knew that the Lord works unto the children of men according to their faith. Examples of this include the brother of Jared moving Mount Zerin by his faith, and the disciples seeing the Lord in great power. He remembered that the Lord had taught about the importance of having hope, that the Lord loved the world and gave his life for it, and that men must have that same kind of love, charity, if they wish to dwell in the mansions of the Father. He knew that if the Gentiles have not charity because of our weakness in writing, that the Lord would take away the blessings reserved for them and give them to others who would receive and accept the Book of Mormon. Moroni then prayed that the Lord would give unto the Gentiles grace that they might have charity. The Lord responded that that shouldn't matter to Moroni, for he had been faithful and would be exalted in the Father's kingdom. Moroni then wrote his third farewell. He intended to conclude his record with the history of the Jaredites, so he took this opportunity to bid farewell unto the Gentiles, yea, and also unto my brethren whom I love. He testified that he had personally seen Jesus face to face, and he exhorted us to seek him so the grace of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost would abide in us forever. After Moroni completed abridging the Jaredite record, he had supposed not to have written more, but I have as not yet perished. Wherefore, I write a few more things, contrary to that which I had supposed. What he wrote next, he hoped, may be of worth unto my brethren the Lamanites in some future day. Moroni's choice of material in Moroni chapters 1 through 6 is different than the controlled narrative we've read thus far. His topics were somewhat miscellaneous, almost like an appendix to a work he considered already completed. He began by quoting the words of Christ, which he spake unto his disciples, the 12 whom he had chosen, as he laid his hands upon them, before ascending into heaven. I mentioned this chapter back in lesson 24. Before Jesus ascended into heaven after his first day with the Nephites, quote, he touched with his hand the disciples whom he had chosen, one by one, even until he had touched them all, and spake unto them as he touched them. And the multitude heard not the words which he spake, therefore they did not bear record, but the disciples bear record, that he gave them power to give the Holy Ghost. Unquote. Moroni here revealed the words Jesus spoke to them. They were to call on the Father in my name in mighty prayer before bestowing the Holy Ghost upon an individual. Priesthood holders today could apply these instructions by preparing spiritually before giving someone the gift of the Holy Ghost. Moroni then wrote of the manner which the disciples, who were called the elders of the church, ordained priests and teachers. The priesthood organization described in the Book of Mormon is quite simple, consisting only of priests, teachers, and elders, all of whom were presided over by a single high priest. After the coming of Christ, it appears that the 12 disciples presided over the church as elders instead of having a high priest. Moroni chapter 3 documents how the disciples ordained priests and teachers. They first prayed unto the Father in the name of Christ, perhaps to seek confirmation that the chosen person had the Lord's approval, then laid their hands upon them and ordained them with a brief prayer. Moroni next documented the manner of their elders and priests administering the flesh and blood of Christ unto the church. Elders, meaning the 12 Nephite disciples, and priests administered the sacrament among the Nephites. They did kneel down with the church when they offered the sacramental prayers. The sacramental prayers are petitions, requests made to God that he would bless and sanctify, that is to say, cleanse or purify, the bread and wine to the souls of all those who partake of it, rather than to just their bodies, which is what bread and wine are typically intended to nourish. This is done in remembrance of the body or blood of the Son of God, in accordance with the instructions the Savior gave the Nephites. The sacrament prayers follow a traditional covenant format, with each side making promises that will be fulfilled if both sides live up to the covenant. Individuals who partake witness, that is to say, testify or attest, unto the Father that they are willing to do three things. Take upon them the name of thy Son, and always remember him, and keep his commandments, which he, the Son, hath given them. Note that the prayers do not indicate that we do these three things, but rather that we are willing to do them. We are imperfect beings who do not always do what we intend to do, but the Lord is merciful and accepts our good faith intent to do them as an acceptable offering. As the Lord revealed through the prophet Joseph Smith, quote, "Behold, the Lord requireth the heart and a willing mind, and the willing and obedient shall eat the good of the land of Zion in these last days." Unquote. President Henry B. Eyring taught, quote, "As I have pondered the covenant words and corresponding blessings promised, I have wondered what it means to be willing to take upon us the name of Jesus Christ." President Dallin H. Oakes explains, "It is significant that when we partake of the sacrament, we do not witness that we take upon us the name of Jesus Christ. We witness that we are willing to do so. The fact that we only witness our willingness suggests that something else must happen before we actually take that sacred name upon us in the most important sense. The statement that we are willing to take upon us his name tells us that while we first took the Savior's name when we were baptized, taking his name is not finished at baptism. We must work continually to take his name throughout our lives, including when we renew covenants at the sacrament table and make covenants in the Lord's holy temples." Unquote. Each week, when we renew our covenants through the administration of the sacrament, the Father covenants in return to always have his Spirit to be with us. Moroni then wrote concerning baptism and new converts. The requirement for baptism among the Nephites was that candidates come forth with a broken heart and a contrite spirit, and witnessed unto the church that they truly repented of all their sins, and took upon them the name of Christ, having a determination to serve him to the end. Following baptism, they were wrought upon and cleansed by the power of the Holy Ghost. Once baptized, individuals were fellowshipped and ministered to as new members of Christ's church. Quote, "They were numbered among the people of the Church of Christ, and their names were taken, that they might be remembered and nourished by the good word of God, to keep them in the right way, to keep them continually watchful unto prayer, relying alone upon the merits of Christ, who was the author and the finisher of their faith." Leaders of the church in modern times have stressed the importance of fellowshipping new converts. In 1997, President Gordon B. Hinckley taught that every new convert needs three things: a friend, a responsibility, and nurturing with the good word of God. In 2010, then Elder Russell M. Nelson taught, quote, "As a member of the church, reach out to those you do not know and greet them warmly. Each Sunday, extend a hand of fellowship to at least one person you did not know before. Each day of your life, strive to enlarge your own circle of friendship." Unquote. Moroni chapter 6 contains information about meetings and discipline in the Church of Christ. The church did meet together oft to fast and pray, to meet the spiritual and temporal needs of the members, and to partake of the sacrament. Among the Nephites, worship meetings were less formal than we're used to. They preached, exhorted, prayed, supplicated, or sang as the Holy Ghost led them to do. Instructions similar to these were given to the restored church in 1830. As the church has grown, this free-form style of worship has given way to the more structured, correlated system we follow today. Those who committed iniquity had their names withdrawn from the membership of the church on the testimony of three witnesses to the elders, that is to say, the 12 disciples. Those who repented, confessed, and sought forgiveness with real intent were forgiven. That concludes this lesson. If you enjoyed it, please click the thumbs up button and leave a comment below. Please subscribe if you'd like to be notified when new lessons are posted to this channel, and visit www.huarc.org to download these notes and this slideshow. Next week will be our last lesson in this Book of Mormon course. We'll finish reading Moroni's Few More Things, which includes three epistles he received from his father and Moroni's final testimony and farewell. The reading is Moroni, chapters 7 through 10. See you next week.